Jim picked up was policy development. And again, like electoral strategy, this is an area where we can have disagreements. But I prefer to take on board a far left slogan, which is unity and after discussion. Or democratic centralism, if you want to use a Leninist phrase, where we thrash out these differences and let the best argument win. Let the best coalition of forces win. And after a period of time, the results themselves will prove whether that way forward was the right way forward. So in terms of policy development, Jim's quite right. We have to appeal to the people who support us on bread and butter issues. It's no good echoing the BNP or echoing the UKIP or echoing the Conservative Party on various issues, because we'll just be lost. We'll be lost in all the noise and we'll sound no different to any of those. So we need to try and outflank, particularly UKIP and the BNP in the early stages, but obviously move on in that respect. And that ties in with what Jim said with regards our proposed policy for Europe, which John Bean has proposed and Jim has happily seconded, with regards our attitude to the European Union, which you can read in the handouts. Now, I'm sure there's some people that will fundamentally disagree and say, no, this is not negotiable. We need to withdraw from the European Union before we can make any policies with regards our relationship with Europe. And I do see the sense in that, and I do sympathise with that after being a member of the BNP for 30 years, obviously. But, as Jim eloquently pointed out, times have changed. The European Parliament, when it was first elected or appointed in 1979, had virtually no representatives from the nationalist parties. They were excluded entirely, and it's only over a period of time that they've made themselves heard. And it is predicted, as Jim again pointed out, that next year's European elections will see a huge block of MPs across Europe entering the European Parliament. Unfortunately, ours will be exiting the European Parliament. So we need to reformulate our strategy, we need to reformulate our attitude and policy to the European Union and to Europe as a whole, because the European Union itself only represents a fraction of Europe. Jim mentioned Switzerland isn't a member of the European Union. Norway isn't a member of the European Union, and parts of the Balkans and so on. But we'll discuss that in the second part of the meeting when we move on to policy, because I'm going to go back to elections, the nuts and bolts of elections, electoral strategy, how to maximise your vote at election time. And right on cue, 1 o'clock, I'll hand you over to Ken Booth. Thanks, Ken.
We outlined a small strategy for fighting standalone by elections, but that strategy can be rolled out for normal council elections. It's just you do more work between now and election time, like Kevin Meeson's doing with his introductory leaflet that he's going to be the candidate. Other parties, brand names, media hype, the average voter knows what they've got to sell. We're at a disadvantage that we've got to put ourselves in the shop window and tell people what we offer them. It's harder work for us. But if you start on the first point on there, we must have a credible, rock-solid local candidate in the ward and will not sort of falter at the last minute, especially if you put several months of campaign work in with a named prospective candidate and they think that come nomination time, ooh, I've changed my mind. You can't really afford that, because you'd have spent quite a lot of money on that and you'd have to do a replacement. The candidate should know the local issues in the ward and be able to engage with the electorate and deal with any media requests that arise during the campaign. So you need a credible local candidate who's ear to the ground, he lives in the ward, he knows all the top issues that are on, you know. From the presentation point of view, this is where we fell down a little bit with Kevin Stafford. If you look at all of Kevin's leaflets, all the pictures are the same. Point three is, once selected, we need lots of pictures of the candidate, plenty of out and about ones, apart from a good few portraits for literature. Be like a bit of a media whore, never miss an opportunity for a photo shoot. If you're out in your ward and you see a big pile of camel dung on the pavement and it's a nuisance, you know, get your picture be taken, picture beside graffiti. If there's any known issues, it's always good if your picture's beside that issue or the landmark in the area where there's trouble. That's invaluable for the local election leaflets, like the A3 one that you've got there. Try not to look too stern, as if you'd, you know, scare the kids off the fireplace. You don't want to be like laughing your head off, but you want to be sort of have that approachable look. On a bit market research, a lot of women voters who've never met the candidate judge what they look like. Believe it or not, if one looks dour and scowling, "Oh, I'm not voting for him," and the other one's smiling, the woman will probably vote for the guy who's smiling on his election leaflet rather than the one that's scowling. But it's the quality of the literature that you need, as well with your issues. And yet all this has got to be done well in advance of next May. While your introductory leaflet's going out that you're going to be, you know, be standing, you need to have all your issues formulated. Our party's very flexible, because if you think it's a local issue that's worth campaigning on, like Kevin did in Hastings, you can campaign on some local issues, as long as it's not going against, you know, major party policy. Prepare your 100 words for the press, and they always want a picture, and that's a little bit extra free publicity. If you haven't got that and the press ring you up, or can have a picture in 100 words, the deadline's tomorrow. If you don't give them the picture in 100 words, you just get a little mention where all the other candidates in the election have got their pictures and their little biog. So you're looking well ahead on this. And what you do need is a small team of local activists who can help. It's a massive advantage when the candidate lives in the ward and they can temporarily use his house as a campaign base for anybody travelling to assist, and you've got all the maps, the literature, canvassing sheets if you've got the manpower to do the canvassing. Everything's there, kept under control, and you can run like a rolling campaign. All too often, we've stood in wards before where nobody lives in the ward. You just come in from nowhere. You know, 12 o'clock, we'll all meet in this pub car park, hand out the maps, everybody goes and buys and leaflets, then goes home. With a rolling campaign, you're not tied to a deadline of time. You can just turn up, pick up your things that you need, go out and do a couple hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, and just hand the sheets back in and your marked up maps. You get a lot more people coming out on a rolling activity than a hard set time and date. The electronic register is quite important. As a party, we're entitled to the free hard copy every December on the new issue. But if you're going to specifically contest an election in a ward, as a candidate, you can request the electronic version, and that's how we do the mail merge letters from the electronic version, the absent voters list, so you know who the postal voters are and you know who the ballot box voters are. Since 2004, they ran test schemes throughout the country. Unfortunately, in the northeast of England, they made us all postal. For the local elections that were concurrent with the European elections that year, there was no polling stations. Everybody had a postal vote. So it then becomes very important that you target the postal voters quickly, especially, and get all your campaign, do your canvassing before the postal ballot packs arrive on the door. All too often things get left and you're delivering stuff and people say, "Oh yeah, you're a great bloke, I'd have voted for you, mate, but I've already sent me voting paper in." So it's quite important to get all your literature out before the postal ballot packs drop through. But anyway, initially you'd start off with a full sweep of a general recruitment leaflet, then move on to a full sweep of a name pictured candidate leaflet. It could be like an A3 newsletter in that case, is what we've done for Kevin Stafford. There's plenty of local issues on there. We do have that section with the national policies, because a lot of people voting for all these local things want to see a bigger picture. You know, should you be elected in enough numbers, could you govern the country, do you have the policies to do that? But anyway, the idea is to start early, have all your stuff prepared. Any prospective candidate should have a good little CV wrote now, just waiting for the by-election, you know, to happen, or build up a team of activists to contest an election next May. But obviously the campaign's now in two parts, especially if you're limited in activists. If you put your main election address out too early, and a lot of you, to coincide with the postal vote, some of the ballot box voters, 3 weeks later, have forgot all about there was an election on. So yeah, it's got to be balanced so there's a constant stream. But it's very important to target the postal voters with a little mail merge letter, which you've seen that one, a personalised letter. By that time, you would have done your introductory leaflet, your mail merge letter, and the main election address. So all those postal voters should have had those three items and hopefully have had the candidate or an agent knocking on the door looking for their support, so they can make an informed choice. They're aware of our candidate, our party, when the ballot papers arrive through the post. Then, once the ballot papers have been delivered by Royal Mail, you've got to then focus on the second part of the campaign, which is targeting to maximise the number of people you can mobilise to go out and vote for you on actual polling day. Activists forbidden, you could start canvassing the ballot box voters, but you certainly want a full sweep of the weekend after the postal votes have been delivered of a campaign update leaflet. That's why it's always good to have plenty different pictures, so you know it's a new fresh image of the candidate and new story, slightly change the colour or the tone of the leaflet. Deliver the mail merge letter to the ballot box voters, which is, it's quite easy. You just take all the postal voter ones out, deliver them first, and you've got plenty of time. You've got, you know, right up until the last weekend of polling day, the Monday, Tuesday, you know, to get those out. But from the, and on the last weekend before polling day, we've put from the Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you can put out, you know, remember to vote this Thursday type leaflet, which is the blue one there. At tea time on polling day, you start looking and you think, well, all these voters that said they were going to vote for us, half of them haven't voted yet. If you've got the manpower, what's called whipping in is to go and knock these people up and remind them or even offer them a lift to the polling station. Because some people just forget to vote. Oh, I've come in from work now, it's raining now, I'm not going back outside. I'll give the elections a miss. And that's why it's important for the remember to vote this Thursday. So people will either go and vote on the way to work or on the way back. The main thing about the election, with not being a known brand, and which probably happened in Hastings, people voted UKIP after the 2-3 years of UKIP question time television. People are starting to link, oh, UKIP, oh, stop immigration. And they're coming in from nowhere and they're picking up the anti-immigration vote, and that's only happened since 2010. So they've stolen the nationalist thunder, because years ago people would have thought of what old party's name and immediately thought, oh, stop immigration, that's what it meant. Now the same has been applied to UKIP. UKIP, the media were quite happy when they were damaging the Tories, but what they've really woke up with the shock now is core Labour voters are voting UKIP, because a lot of those Labour Party people are just fed up with the back teeth of immigration and things that have gone wrong. But the main thing on the elections, you've got to have something to sell. If you look at, you know, Kevin's first leaflet, there's quite a few local issues on there. Some of them he makes a comment, some of them he doesn't. But it does give you the impression that, oh, here's somebody who lives in the ward and knows what's happening in the ward. Like the UKIP candidate, he put on his leaflet, he wanted to save the medical centre that was going to close, which had already closed 7 months previously. So you've got a mix of mainly local issues for a local election and a small amount of national policies for the bigger picture.